gain by laboring these points. These difficulties will all be offset in due time through the growth of understanding, by the intuitive diagnosis of disease, and by the magnificent work of scientific and academic medicine, plus a truer comprehension of right living conditions. Still wider generalizations which will indicate causes and will not emphasize the consequences of these causes. I seek, therefore, to point out that 1. The soil of the planet itself is a major cause of disease and of contamination. For untold eons, the bodies of men and of animals have been laid away in the ground. That soil is consequently with the germs and the results of disease, and this in a far subtler form than is surmised. The germs of ancient known and unknown diseases are to be found in the layers of the soil and the subsoil. These can still produce virulent trouble if presented with proper conditions. Let me state that nature never intended that bodies would be buried in the ground. The animals die and their bodies can cause death as well as life, and the most virulent germs and bacteria cannot retain their potency if submitted to the dry heat of the sun's rays. Moisture and darkness foster disease as it emanates from and is nourished by bodies from whence the life aspect has been drawn. When, in all countries throughout the world, the rule is to submit dead forms to the ordeal by fire, and when this has become a universal and persistent habit, we shall then see a great diminution of disease in a much healthier world. 2. The psychological condition of a race or of a nation, as we have seen, produces a tendency to disease and to a lowered resistance to the causes of disease. It can engender an ability to absorb evil contamination with facility. Nourishment of the youth of the race. National physical ills vary according to the predisposing occupations of the people. The diseases of an agricultural race will differ widely from those of a highly industrialized race. The physical predispositions of a sailor vary greatly from those of an office worker in one of our large cities. These items of information are again with the attitudes of the social worker in the many cities and lands. Certain diseases appear to be purely local, others seem universal in their effects. Certain diseases sentient racial period lies thousands of years away. A great majority of people today are basically Atlantean in their consciousness, and are therefore prone to the diseases of that civilization. If a full review of the health of the world were to be undertaken and presented to the thinking public, taken in normal conditions and not in wartime, the question arises whether there are 100,000 perfectly healthy people to be found out of the billions now inhabiting the Earth. I think not. If no actual and active disease is present, nevertheless the condition of the teeth, the hearing and the sight leave frequently much to be desired. Inherited tendencies and active predispositions cause great concern, and to all this must be added psychological difficulty, mental diseases and definite brain trouble. All this presents an appalling picture. Against the ills which it discloses, medicine is today battling. Scientists are searching for alleviations and cures and for sound and lasting methods of eradication. Research students are investigating the latent germs, and health experts are seeking new ways to meet the onslaught of disease. Sanitation, compulsory inoculation, frequent inspection, pure food laws, legal requirements and better housing conditions are all brought into this battle by the far-seeing humanitarian. Yet still disease is rampant, more hospitals are required and the death rate soars. To these practical agencies, mental science, new thought, unity and Christian Science offer their aid, and seek quite honestly to bring the power of the mind to bear upon the problem. At the present stage, these agencies and groups largely are in the hands of fanatics and devoted, unintelligent people. They refuse all compromise and seem unable to recognize that the knowledge accumulated by medicine and by those who work scientifically with the human body is as God-given as their, as yet, unproven ideal. Later, the truths for which these groups stand will be added to the work of the psychologist and the physician. When this has been done, we shall see a great improvement. Physical body is recognized as essential and good, when the analysis and conclusions of the psychologist supplement their work, and when the power of right thought comes likewise as an aid, then and only then, shall we enter upon a new era of well-being. Copyright 1998 Loses Trust. 151. A Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4. Esoteric healing. To the various categories of trouble must also be added a whole group of diseases which are more strictly mental in their effect, the cleavages, the insanities, the obsessions, the mental breaks, the aberrations and the hallucinations. To the various healing agencies mentioned above should be added the work undertaken by members of the spiritual hierarchy and their disciples. It takes soul power and knowledge, plus the wisdom of the other healing groups, to produce health among people, to empty our sanitariums, to rid humanity of the basic diseases, of lunacy and obsession, and to prevent crime. This is finally brought about by the right integration of the whole man, through a right comprehension of the nature of energy, and through a correct appreciation of the endocrine system, its glands and their subtle relationships. At present there is little coherent and integrated work done in unison by the four groups. 1. Physicians and surgeons, orthodox and academic. 2. Psychologists, neurologists and psychiatrists. arrive at an understanding of the true wonder of the human being. We shall someday have hospitals in which the four phases of this one medical and remedial work will proceed side by side and in the fullest cooperation. Neither group can do a complete task without the others. All are interdependent. It is the inability of these groups to recognize the good in the other groups striving for the physical well-being of humanity which makes it almost impossible for me to do more specific teaching and more direct talking on these matters. Have you any idea of the wall of antagonistic thinking and speech against which a new or pioneering idea has to batter itself? Have you ever seriously considered the aggregated and crystallized thought forms with which all such new ideas, and shall I call them hierarchical proposals, have to contend? Do you appreciate the dead weight of preconceived and ancient determinations which have to be moved before the hierarchy can cause a new and needed concept to penetrate into the consciousness of the average thinking, or again should I say, unthinking, public? The field of medicine is a most difficult field in which to work, for the subject is so intimate, and fear enters so strongly into the reactions of those who must be reached. The gulf between the old and established and the new and the spiritually demanded